Hello, I am Professor Loda, belonging to Civil Engineering Department, LE College, Morbi. Today we are going to discuss Geographic Information System, introductory part of it. In previous lectures, we had discussion on global positioning system and remote sensing. In continuation of that, we are discussing today Geographic Information System. As the name indicates, that it's a system. It's not a direct survey method, but it manages information which is geographically referenced. If you split the title Geographic Information System, then all three terms which are on your screen, that geography, information and system are important. Geographic in surveys, mostly we take the data or the readings of geographic locations, geographic altitudes, and that become information for us. We need to arrange it systematically in various formats. Information, the system containing this information, systematic information, is what is we consider as GIS. This is part, my information is on screen. You may interact with me at my email address given at the bottom of this screen. This screenshot carries the module 2 of syllabus, GTU syllabus of subject elements of civil engineering. GIS is part of this module. The second leveling carries certain advanced surveying tools, GPS, remote sensing, and GIS. Under that we are studying. And we discussed, the teaching hours are 6, and module weightage given to this is 12%. The topics which we are going to cover today are the certain definitions of GIS, then domains in which GIS is leading nowadays, objectives of GIS, capabilities of GIS, or we can say the strength of GIS, components of which the GIS is made of, then GIS is important as far as data management is concerned. So we are going to discuss a little bit on GIS data representation and vector data models. We are also going to discuss non-spatial data, and at the end we'll discuss the GIS outputs and cartographic outputs. This is a definition of a GIS. A geographic information system is any system that captures, stores, analyzes, manages, and presents data that are linked to locations. The definition is very elaborate. It covers almost all aspects of a good geographic information system. That the system should be in position to capture the data in itself. The first requirement of a good GIS is that it should be in position to capture data. Then it should have facilities to store the data, capture data, or the brought in data into the different modules of GIS, that the GIS should provide us facility to storing the data. Then we should have certain statistical methods to analyze the data, which are there already stored in the GIS. And through analysis, what we do, we manage, we present, and based on this these outputs, we take the right decision to carry forward the various projects. In simplest term, GIS is the merging of cartography, statistical analysis, and database technology. That if we just simplify, then it is three things: that we are managing data, analyzing data, and taking certain output, cartographical output, that is maps, charts, and other pictorial form of the output. So basically, this is management of data, survey data. So this has become part of survey. And in civil engineering, we have lot of emphasis on surveying methods, surveying tools, surveying data. So for civil engineers and also for other engineering branches, this GIS is proving equally important. This is a data-driven software. This is a data-driven tool which is enabling engineers to take better decisions. This screen shows us that where the GIS is dominating, that the areas in which it is having its footprints, the first is archaeology. It is being used in managing the various sites. Geography, the various features on our surface. Cartography, the map making, which is the basis of GIS is basis of map making nowadays. In earlier days, it used to be very manual. Manually, things were created, like topo sheets and other things. Now, GIS is giving us more freedom, more flexibility in creating maps at different scales and with the different locations, different territories, and those all things are merging into GIS. GIS also dominating into remote sensing, because the captured data through remote sensing becomes direct input into GIS and can be analyzed. Then land surveying, what we do in survey laboratories, the data which we captured manually or through the various mechanical and electronic instrument like Distomate or like total station, those data also come into GIS and become a management tool or say a information system. Public utility management, natural resources management. We'll discuss on these topics at a later stage where it is dominating. That urban planning GIS is having footprints. Disaster management, navigation, localized search engines in which we fetch information which is there in the GIS system. The basic objectives of GIS are onto the screen. The first one is maximizing the efficiency of decision making and planning. That the stored data, analysis of the data gives us output giving us freedom to take decision. So this is a flexible source or say immediate source of analysis, and results can be used in decision making. Provide efficient means for data distribution and handling, that at various locations data can be collected, gathered, entered, and at a particular place this data can be stored and analyzed. So it's a very inefficient system or a means of data distribution and handling. It eradicates the duplicate data. In data, most of the time we suffer the redundancy problem. And in particularly GIS, we use different databases which allow us to remove the duplication of the data, thereby reducing the total storage on the system or different files, and that eradication gives us more effective output in form of tables, in form of maps, in form of charts. Integration of information is also objective, that from various sources, many sources, we collect the data for a particular project, and GIS become a integration central nodal point or a nodal software in which the all data are going. So that is also a very important role GIS play in most of the project preparation. Analysis of queries involving geographical reference data for generation of new information. As I said, that the GIS is mostly a georeferenced tool. Means all the data are georeferenced. Any location which is entered into GIS would have certain geographical reference. So while querying, we find that the georeference data we could retrieve and we could generate new information based on the whole data or part of the data. We can update the data easily. Since data is in soft copies, the deletion or alteration or updation of data is very easy, and the cost involved in this kind of upgradation is, we can assume, is, would be very less. Let's look at the capabilities of GIS, or we can say strength at which the GIS is most suitable. So first, among the five generic questions which GIS can solve is the location. Because I repeat it many times and throughout this lecture that the information or data in GIS is georeferenced, and in terms of that every location, every data is in form of XY or say lat long position. So when we retrieve, when we query something, then what we get is the coordinates of that particular point. So locational positions are what we get from the GIS. So this is one of the biggest strength of GIS, that XY coordinates, lat long, these are the universal lat long. Yes, these are not the arbitrary like we do it on the graph paper or graph sheet, XY coordinates, but these are the universal coordinates what we get from the GIS. The second is the condition. Condition of a particular question, the answer to this question inform where the certain enlisted conditions are satisfied. They, suppose we ask the system after creation of a GIS application, we ask that how many hospitals are there in 5 kilometer radius from here. I'm sitting at Bizeg and I'm looking at that in case of casualty or something, then what would be the number of hospital, or where would be the nearest hospital. So those conditions, if satisfied, then GIS would provide us the total conditional answers. So this is also a biggest what we call is strength of GIS. Trends is the third strength of GIS. This question seeks to find out what has changed since, like the development of Gandhinagar since last 30 years or 40 years, or since its inception as capital of Gujarat. What has changed? If we have different data sets over the years, over the decades of these 4 decades, then trend can be easily established, and that can be tracked. We could have various maps every decade, say during 70s, during 80s, during 90s, last decade of the century, or during these two first decades of the 21st century, what has been the effective changes and how the changes are taking place. Those are the capabilities of GIS as far as trends are concerned. Then the pattern is also important, how the changes are taking place, how the things are changing over time period. So what is pattern? It is about various spatial patterns which exist. GIS answer this logical question by giving information about distribution of spatial features and reasons behind that distribution. That the GIS is supported with many statistical tools, that inbuilt tools are there in the various GIS programs which we work with. So what has changed over, and what are the patterns taking place, and how things are spreading out? So that particular thing can also be monitored with GIS. Lastly, the fifth strength of the GIS is its capability to model the phenomena, model the trend, model the pattern, or model various conditions which we have talked about to get the information, futuristic information. So modeling is the strength. GIS becomes a predecessor or say input into the modeling data, and It gives, it enables scientists, engineers to analyze and then forecast what would be after, say, 10 years during 2020 or 2030 or 2040. So those things can be predicted with certain help of various other tools along with GIS. In this case, GIS would be the input into the modeling. So this enhances the modeling of the GIS. So these are the five basic strengths, or we can say capabilities, of GIS. Let's look at various components. Since you are beginner into GIS, you are just starting going through the engineering course. This is very first year of your engineering course. So you should understand that what are the constituent part of the GIS. So if broadly we define GIS, we can break it up into five important components consisting of the hardware, software. Like hardware, your computer, disk on it, CPU. Hardware, the software we install to create a GIS application. Then the data we enter into the software. Then the methods adopted to enter data, to retrieve data, those procedures, and the person, people who are using it, who are going to get benefit of this GIS application. So in component, we generally draw a kind of a sketch. At the center, we put the software and hardware, and then around it, data is going into it. People are interacting with it. Certain methods are employed or put into it. So these are basically five methods which are interacting with each other and carrying information and analyzing finally and getting output for the sake of people. The first component we were talking about, that computer software, so little bit elaboration on that, that it includes the programs and an interface that we need to talk with the software. So it also has its own interface, which generally talk with the user using this GIS application. So it's a program and an interface which can be used for driving the hardware. The GIS software module is very important component, as it is responsible for generating, storing, analyzing, manipulating, and displaying the data or geographical information. Whatever we do with the software tool, and all the analysis, all the statistical methods are there embedded into the software. Second is the hardware. Hardware is where the software loaded onto. So basically CPU, the computer system, or your laptop, where we install the GIS software and then create GIS application. The other things which are important in GIS are like digitizer. Many a times data are not digitized, like no digital data available. We have to create the digital data, like the analog maps are available, topo sheets are available, but we don't have digital maps. So in that case, we digitize it. Digitization is a process through which we create the soft copy of hard map and then put it into the system or a GIS software and then use it for further. So that is the digitization. Scanners we use to scan, create the raster image of a hard copy, are used for converting the data which is available in the form of maps or documents into digital form. Then along with it, the kind of display device or a plotter is used which present the result of the data processing. In GIS, as I discussed earlier, that data may be primary or secondary data. Primary data need to be collected point to point, or through the primary surveys we collect primary data. Secondary data can be purchased from the commercial data provider, and that can be part of the system GIS application. The second, the key functionality of GIS is integration of spatial and tabular data stored in database management system, that is DBMS. The key functionality of GIS is integration of spatial data and tabular data. What is spatial data? The data which is having extent in space, that is the spatial data. And tabular data, the data in form of that in 1990, what was the population of Gujarat state? In 1991, what was the population? And over the years, what are the changes? So the year and the population number are tabulated. That is tabulated data. Whereas the space data is the map of Gujarat. It does have a kind of extent in the space. It's a special data. So GIS is very good tool to integrate these two data, that special data can be integrated with the tabular data through management of this data. And generally, we use database management system for that. Then the people, we user of the GIS. GIS technology is useless without people power. That if we don't know how to use, how to create GIS application, then GIS of no use. The advancement of technology led to understanding of that how geographic information system could be powerful tool in understanding the data, understanding the geographical features, and taking various decisions. Many technological inventions and structures are built because of certain analysis done through geographically referenced data on GIS platforms. GIS has a wide range of users, from specialists who design it to end users. Many a times end users don't know what is there inside the GIS application. They directly want to use and want to see the output, like map of Ahmedabad city, how it would be, where would be the different parts, where would be, say, a secretariat in the Gandhinagar. So locational positions are also can be retrieved or can be queried into GIS application. Methods or procedures are the things which are there embedded, and many a times we also facilitate the data inputting into the GIS application so that we could retrieve a good information out of the GIS application. The right method is key for successful operation of GIS technology. The well-designed implementation plan, that is algorithms and business rules, are unique to each organization and they should be taken care of while creating a GIS application. Since the data is very important, data is core of GIS. So how the GIS data handling is done or data is represented into the system, into the GIS application? So that is what we are going to discuss through next few slides, that GIS data representation. Look at it, that GIS data represents real objects, that every part, every location on this earth surface is can be represented in the GIS application. Represents real objects such as roads can be brought into GIS application, land use like grass or say ponds or road network or say power plants or anything which are there onto earth surface can be really represented in a GIS environment. Elevations, trees, waterways, etc. Digital data determining the mix. Real objects can be divided into two forms or abstractions. One, that are discrete objects, like one point thing. They do not are having a continuous spatial expanse. So they are called discrete objects. Second is the continuous field, such as rainfall amount or extent, then elevations. They are continuously going changing over space. So continuous field, discrete objects and continuous fields. Let's discuss more about these two, that how they can be handled in the GIS environment. Traditionally, there are two broad methods used to store spatial data in GIS for both kinds of abstractions, mapping references. One is the raster data model, that is a sales and a grid-based data model, and second is vector data model, which is consisting of points, lines, and polygon. Raster data model basically is cells and grid. It is a grid which is consisting of many cells. Say a grid consisting of 10 by 10. So it would be having 100 cells and each cell is getting information. Most of the time when we take a photograph, then the data is stored in this format, cell format or grid format. Each pixel or each cell is getting certain information. More the cell, more would be the resolution of that particular photograph or say data set. Unlike this raster, vector data model only represents a particular thing. In case of discrete data, a tree would be denoted by a point, a river would be like through a line, or a say grass field through a polygon. So it's not having a that continuous long. It requires lesser space compared to raster, but raster is important in certain data categories, and vector is important in other categories. The use of raster and vector data model depends upon the area in which we are working. So that particular analysis would lead us to use a particular set of data or creation of a particular data. This picture shows us that if we want to represent a real world situation, which is on the top of this out of three sketches, the one which is at the top represents a real world situation. Hut is there. There is a road in brown color, a blue color river kind of thing is shown, and few trees are there in the field, and area is bound through a rectangular space. Now, this can be converted into GIS data in two ways. That first, we divide this whole space into grid given onto the left side of the screen, that the whole area is divided into cells having a certain measurement. It can be, we can increase the number of cells or decrease the number of cells. By increasing or decreasing, we increase or decrease the storage space of this particular area onto the disk. And the various items or objects onto real field situation are converted like brown. There are few cells, brown cells, which represents the road network. There is a light brown that represents hut, then blue cells representing the river, and the green cells denoting the trees. There are one, two, three, and four green cells, and in the above picture we could locate that the four trees are denoted through four cells. Now onto the right side, the same real world situation is converted into the GIS data set through vector data model. And in this, the brown road line is given a straight line, not cells, but a straight line. Then a blue river is also shown through a line, is converted into. The hut is there through a polygon. It's not a cell, but it's a polygon. Then three trees are combined by a different polygon, that this area is populated through trees. We can say if there are more trees, this is a forest. And onto the right side of the river, there is one tree, so it's a smaller polygon shown. So this is the vector representation. The data would be stored, the information would be stored in GIS. And when we query something, then the data would be fetched accordingly. In the raster, that the cell information would be provided. Here, the polygon or point or line information would be provided. Comparing raster and vector data models, that which one is better, or that which particular data set is suitable for what conditions. So let's see a few points on this raster and vector data. Raster data sets record a value for all points in the area that we have seen just covered, which may require more storage space than representing data vector format that can store data only where needed. Raster data allows easy implementation of overlay operation. This is one kind of operation in GIS environment, that one layer, GIS basically create maps in layer formats. One layer, there may be many layers, one above other, and the interaction of this layer or the combination of these layer is possible. So that is easy in raster compared to the vector. Vector data can be displaced as vector graphic used on traditional maps, like line would be line, whereas raster data will appear as an image that may have blocky appearance for objects. So visually it is not pleasant. Vector data can be easier to register, scale, and reproject. There are projection systems in GIS. If you are going deep into this, then you would find that many projection systems exist. So reprojection of vector data is easy compared to the raster. Vector data is more compatible with relational database environments. As we have seen that the GIS is basically a data-driven software or application. In case of vector data, these databases, relational databases, can easily be managed in the vector, whereas in case of raster, the relational things are very less, that what would be onto the left side of river or what would be onto the right side of road network, or what would be onto, say, 5 kilometer radius of a particular city center. So those kind of relational databases can be managed easily in the vector databases. Vector file size are usually smaller. They are 10 to rasters are 10 to 100 times larger than vector data. More space is required for raster. Vector data is simpler to update and maintain, whereas raster needs expertise. Vector data allows much more analysis capability compared to the raster, especially for network analysis. This is big component of GIS for road, power, rail, telecommunication. We need network analysis, and if data is in form of vector data in GIS, then this analysis can be done more efficiently. What we studied, these two data, these two both, like discrete or continuous field, both are spatial data which has their presence in space, x, y, z coordinates. Certain things are not spatial data. They are just information about these spatial items, like how many rooms a particular hospital or a particular building have, then that number of rooms become non-spatial information, or number of beds in a hospital, number of classrooms in a school, or say number of branches going through in your engineering college. All these are non-spatial data, but your college, engineering college, is a spatial data. So non-spatial data can be attached to spatial data. All data which appear, whether raster or vector data, they would be visible, they can be shown pictorially, but non-spatial data can be attached with, and that information can be brought onto the map or in form of tables, that output can be taken out. In raster data, the cell value can be stored attribute information, but it can also be used as an identifier that can relate to records in another table. Data output and cartography. We have seen two types of data, that one is the spatial data and the second is non-spatial data. After analysis, what we are interested in that we should get output. Most of the time, we are interested in taking output in form of maps, sometimes in form of tables. Cartography is science of map making. In earlier days, this was a totally manual work, There used to be cartographers who create map. They were employed into various agency like Survey of India, and other agency also used to keep these cartographs. Nowadays, this has been converted to GIS experts, and GIS experts create maps through data analysis onto GIS applications. Now, that cartography, GIS handle all these things very nicely and creates good maps through the analysis of the data. Data output basically is in the form of map, like how maps are created. GIS gives us various layers. We could switch on, put certain layers on, certain layers off in the GIS application, and then clubbing all those layers, the maps are created. I give you example of a particular map, we want to create a map of land use, land cover in a particular river basin. Then what would be requirement that we should have the data about the land use, land cover. The data may be faced through remote sensing, or maybe through manual surveys through various agencies or government departments, and then can be brought into. Then finally, what we are interested that the total the river basin, particular river basin, say Sabarmati river basin, what are the land uses in this? So that map can be taken out of the given GIS application. Or we could take map of say services provided in city, like where the drainage exists in Ahmedabad city and which areas are not having drainage system. GIS is also used to collect taxes, so those maps that where the tax collection can be done through GIS applications, they can be marked and output can be taken. So that is what the data output and cartography of the GIS. That's all about today's lecture. What we have learned is that the definition, various definitions of GIS, then GIS data handling. Two types, that one is the special databases and second was the non-special databases, and then how the outputs can be taken from the GIS in form of maps or tables. Thank you.